Welcome to Superwomen. The healthcare industry in our country has been growing in leaps and bounds for the past few decades. Although it is still predominantly and unfortunately a male-centric industry, there have been few but powerful women that have pioneered achievements. One such individual is Dr. Minnie Bodhanwala, a woman that believes in the mantra of simple living and high thinking. Dr. Minnie, an absolute honor to have you with us today. Thank you so much. Dr. Minnie, like I mentioned, you are a woman of simple living and high thinking, and probably that's what initiated your journey into service to mankind. Would that be right if I said that?
I think you are right, because I had a very simple living, but my thinking was always innovative. And I think that is the mantra behind this success which I have today.
Right. And you started off your career as a dental surgeon, and then you moved on to the management part of it, because now you're the CEO of the Wadia Hospitals and Nauroji Maternity Wadia Hospital, as well as the Bai Children's Wadia Hospital, and leading two heritage hospitals, probably the largest in our country. How has the transition been from healthcare to management?
The transition has been full of challenges. But I think we women can take up challenges more than our male counterparts, and I'm happy to say that.
Right.
Because the challenges we have are something different. But I think in a successful world where we are today, It is very important we understand our basic roles, we see whatever our goals are, And reach to that.
Mm-hmm.
It was not an easy journey from being a dentist to come as a management person, and I'm not only a management person, but I'm also as a quality person. So it's all just like you can say, it's everything in one basket, which I deliver.
True. So it's everything that comes along with your experience And expertise that you offer to the Wadia hospitals.
Yes.
Also, ma'am, I happen to read that you took up the challenge of leading the Wadia hospitals in the year 2012. During a phase when it was undergoing a lot of challenges, the situation was in a bit of a crisis, if I may say so. How did you take up that challenge?
I'm basically known to take up challenges and deliver. So I took up the challenge, and I think I have delivered very well.
Mm-hmm.
The challenge was that it was a heritage structure. There were old timers in this institute. Plus also that the grants from the governments were not coming on time. So we had to become part self-sustainable. And also changes in the technology, infrastructure, which was much needed, and the attitude of people.
Mm-hmm.
So to get that change, it took me around 2.5-3 years. And today we see what Wadia hospitals are.
Absolutely. It's for the world to see where Wadia Hospital is standing.
Yes, I think so.
Definitely. So when we mention about the achievements of Wadia Hospital, I think it is necessary to definitely mention the fact that the NICU, the Neonatal Intensive Care Unit in the Children's Hospital, is the largest in the world, and that has happened under your leadership.
Yeah, when I joined Wadia about 5 years back, we had only a 19-bedded NICU with just 2 ventilators.
Mm.
Today we have an NICU which is 150 bedded, and plus another PICU, CICU, which is about 70 beds. So totally we are above 200 beds of ICU, and the number of ventilators are more than 75. So internationally also, which says 1:4 beds, but we are more than that. So I think Wadia Hospital stands out by itself in the world of pediatrics.
How do you manage this, ma'am? Because as a charitable institution, there's a lot that you need to consider, because on one side, you need to make sure that you have the best of doctors and healthcare professionals in the industry. And on the other side, you need to make sure that the services that's provided to patients is economically viable as well. So how does that balance happen?
That is where I come in, and that's where my role is. We have to manage everything with what we have. Mm-hmm. We have the best of faculties with us because we are a teaching institute.
Yeah.
And we have a good list of donors and CSR activities. So because of all these activities coming under one roof, we are able to manage the hospital and show the success of the hospital and also the success of our patients. the main success is our patients.
They are
Very happy,
right?
And that is where they all come in, because the cost to them is negligible.
Right.
To some, it is no cost. So I think that is where we move forward.
So, ma'am, when we talk about being on par with global standards as far as the healthcare services provided at Wadia hospitals go, what is your approach to identifying where what is needed, what is lacking, and how to meet the demand?
Being a quality person and a management person, and always keeping in touch with the global standards, we see that we maintain them and we have them with us. We have numerous trainings organized for our staff in-house and outsourced, and we see to it that they also are kept abreast with that. For us, patient and employee safety come first. So we keep up to all the patient safety goals with us.
Besides the regular the work schedule that happens at the Wadia hospitals, in your capacity as a CEO, you've also spearheaded a lot of other initiatives. For instance, the Little Hearts Marathon, Hospital on Wheels, all of this has happened under your leadership. Could you tell us a bit about those, ma'am?
Yeah, these are parts of the activities which I enjoy, where I do something for people, where people can actually benefit the underprivileged. So Little Hearts Marathon, we had started around 5 years back, and that was an initiative where we did not have a cardiology department. So whatever funds came in, and this was only for the children, we saw that there was no marathon, no exercise going out for children. We said, let's get into an innovative idea, and we got that going. And I think today, we have a lot of good things getting done. We have our own OT set up with that. Plus, I mean, in the last 1 year, we have treated more than 350 cardiac children, giving them all a new life. Maybe tomorrow they'll be citizens of, I mean, they may be top leaders of the world,
right?
Anywhere they could move.
So I understand that children are at the heart of most of your initiatives and most of the things that you do. There's also an IVF center that's attached to the Wadia hospitals, also a milk bank, which is often unheard of in the healthcare industry. So how did all this happen, ma'am? From where did the idea arise for meeting all these needs?
These ideas actually are given to me by my team, because they feel that whatever we are lacking, they come up with one and one idea, and they see to me as a leader to get them implemented. So all my success also goes to my team with me.
So you have a strong team that's constantly backing you and providing you support, and you encourage each other, as I understand.
It's not only my team, it's also my chairman, Mr. Tasli Wadia, my manager, MD, Mr. Ness Wadia, and all my board members who have always stood by me in whatever new initiative, and you know, they have facilitated whatever we needed. So because of that, it was easy.
Right. Ma'am, now that you've mentioned your chairman, there's another interesting observation that I made. During your career progression, you started off as a dental surgeon, but then you also took up roles in other industries. You also headed Bombay Dyeing for a while.
No, I have not headed. I'm only a director with Bombay Dyeing.
Right, right.
And National Peroxide Limited,
yes,
and also
yes.
Bombay Burma. Well, I see to it that because, you know, I have a degree which says not only healthcare, I'm basically an MBA into finance also.
Wow.
So it's an interesting role for me. And as long as I deliver and people are happy. That's what we want.
Great. There's another incident that really caught my attention, ma'am, during your course of being the CEO of the Wadia hospitals. There was an incident of the Palghar babies in the year 2015, if I'm not mistaken, where two girl babies were abandoned by their parents because of a genetic disorder that the children had. Could you narrate the story behind that and your involvement in this?
It happened actually in 2013 May.
Okay.
And this will be the fifth year. The two babies were conjoined from the torso, and they shared a number of organs. And they were in India. It's very easy, you know, for these uneducated people that saying that it is, you know, evil. So you have to do things to them and all. They literally wanted to, you know, just let the babies go. Then a social worker got them to our hospital. My team of doctors doing the surgery were very, very impressed. They said, ma'am, they don't have money. Let us see, how can we do it? I said, you admit the patients, we'll see to it. And after they admitted, on the third day we operated the patients because they were infected, these two babies. And then after 6 months, in January 2014, it was a mere 12-hour surgery with around a team of 20 doctors which separated these two children. And when we separated these children, our team of doctors was in touch with team of doctors in US. So everything was being, you know, coincided that nothing should go wrong, because by in 6 months' time, the hospital started loving these children as their own. So, you know, the emotional attachment was much more. Like my surgeon told me, ma'am, when I took up the scalpel, I could only see your eyes and sing that you are going to succeed, do it, go on.
That's great, that's great. And I believe the children are still under the patronage of the hospital, as I understand.
Yeah, basically the parents abandoned them because they were non-affording. But not only because of that, because they were two girl child and they wanted a male child. And we at Wadia Hospital always think girl child and girl empowerment. So, you know, we have taken them as our own children and we have kept them with us. I mean, now they go to school, they pass their senior KG, and in May they'll be celebrating their fifth birthday.
How fabulous is that? It's a moment of pride for you and the hospital itself.
Yeah, it's a moment of pride for the whole hospital, because all the staff thinks them to be their own children. So, I mean, the love and affection they would have got just from two parents, here they have it from more than 1,000 staff. So there's an abundance of love for them in this hospital.
Bless the children. Ma'am, now, after discussing this incident, there are two questions related to this that I would like to ask. One is, you mentioned about how superstitious generally our community can be when it comes to general practices that have been, you know, passed on since ages. As a healthcare professional and as having experienced this a lot in your field of work, what do you think needs to be done to make sure that our society is rid of all these evils?
I think we need to remove the stigma, first of all. And I think an awareness should be created, because you find that most of the people who are uneducated, living in such villages, will be always carried by this.
True.
But in case we have these ASHA workers, as we say in India, you know, teaching them and creating the awareness, then I don't think we could have such situations coming up.
So you believe that the core issue needs to be tackled right from the roots?
Yeah, it has to be tackled from the root, and the thing of all these superstitions should be moved out. I know it is difficult in an age-old country like India, where you have a heritage of things going on. So it'll take time, but if everybody moves together as one, and especially I feel women moving together as one, nobody can stop that happening.
Absolutely. So my second question is this, ma'am: the role of women and women empowerment in this, in the grander scheme of things, what do you see? Where do you see that heading to? How important is that?
I think women empowerment is something wonderful, but also at the same time, the women need to understand that whatever positions, whatever powers they've been given, to utilize it in the correct way and not to misuse those powers. Because misuse of power again brings the women down. So women on such positions need to understand and grow ahead and keep their eyes on their goals. If they keep their eye and a strong vision, I guess every woman can just achieve it. It's not that hard. It's only what your mindset is.
Absolutely. So how would you describe your leadership, as if I can ask you to describe your leadership style in a single word? What, how would you describe it?
I am a visionary with a goal in a mind, and I am a team player. I don't work in a solo. I work in a team, and my team is my greatest strength with me. And that's what leads to completing my vision and my goal.
Great. Ma'am, now we're discussing, like I initially mentioned, we're talking about how much India as a country has progressed in terms of healthcare, in terms of the healthcare industry developing and improving. We're almost on par with any globally acclaimed hospital, which is why probably medical tourism as an industry, as a field, as a sector is improving in the coming years. Where do you see, or what role do you see Wadia hospitals playing in medical tourism?
Medical tourism is something we are now looking at, because in the last 5 years, the transformation which Wadia Hospital has undergone is something marvelous. And I would say it's no more a hospital only for the underprivileged, but stands out as one in the world. We have the latest technology, we have the latest knowledge with our doctors, and there is nothing which our doctors cannot do. We have the greatest of infrastructure. And being a 90-year-old hospital, I think it is a privilege and pride for anybody working in Wadia Hospital to reach to this level. Absolutely. So already we are on the global map. It's just a little more work from our side to push it for medical tourism. And I hope that along with the UAE government, we can have some good relationships and ties of Wadia hospitals.
Absolutely. So what are the steps, ma'am, that you wish to take for the future to make sure that all your goals are being achieved?
The future steps would be that I would like to have tie-ups, move ahead with prestigious institutions in the world, student exchange programs, because already we are having inquiries coming for students from UK and US to come to our hospital to train. So that is something, so unless it's lacking somewhere over there, that students are going to come to India to train, and that could be nothing more than a feather in the cap for all of us.
Absolutely, certainly. How do you plan on meeting this requirement? Because this would be moving on to an educational sector as well, as far as having an exchange, student exchange program is concerned. How would that happen?
Yeah, we are already working up in the field of orthopedics, pediatric orthopedics. We will then move on to pediatric cardiology, as well as the other super speciality services which we will be having. Now we are going to have even the pediatric neurosurgery starting, which will be very, very good. It's already started, but I mean the topmost of new things will be coming in for that.
Right. Ma'am, before we let you go, I'd like to ask you your idea of entrepreneurship. If there are budding entrepreneurs, what is the one message that you would like to give them?
The message to entrepreneurs is, see, you have a lot of thorns in your way and you have a lot of challenges. So, I mean, we should not take a setback if something happens. Take it, you know, as a stepping stone to success and just keep moving on. Don't get demotivated in any part of your life. You just need to be motivated. Okay, take that failure as a success and move on.
Learn the lesson and move on. Now, because ours is a woman-oriented program, is there anything specific that you would like to share with the women out there?
I think I would like to share with women that women need to come out of the households and move on to more challenging careers. It's not that, you know, you just sit at home. No, things need to move out. You need to show your talent. You need to show what you have. And good luck to all the women for that.
How do you, what would be your one single advice for women that wish to multitask as well, juggling multiple fields like you are doing with such ease? Is there anything special you would like to mention there?
Yeah, I think women need to come out, and I think we need to also have platforms. Like you, I think I had a Brands Impact Award yesterday. I mean, that motivates me still more. True. So we all need to come out, show, motivate ourselves and move forward. So I actually am even thankful to the Brands Impact for motivating me to come to Dubai and have an interaction with you all over here, and also share my views over here and my ideas and my success here.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Minnie Bodhanwala. It has been an absolute pleasure having you here with us today, and we are extremely honored to have had this experience.
Thank you.
Thank you.